we saw how these rules, they are the execution backtracks through them to generate all the solutions, one solution at the time. But this pattern matching, or as it's called in Prolog, unification, that was working under the hood. We didn't try to do anything complicated and fancy, so hopefully you accepted that when I say male x, so that this pattern, this free unbound variable x, can match Bob, or it can match Tom. So what exactly is going on in here in this pattern matching or unification? So unification is a powerful thing that is easy to confuse with the assignment or equality comparison of imperative programming languages. So this fourth video, so here I'm gonna be now showing some examples of this unification and its variations so that you see exactly what is going on. So unification, what it does is very simple. It's one sentence, but the problem is avoid hallucinating that some other things might happen along the way. The same thing when I was teaching assignment in Python in the first programming course. So all that it does, evaluate the right-hand side and then assign the result to be the new value of the left-hand side variable. So we can use especially the is variant of unification as assignment, but the unification is more powerful, more flexible, more general, and therefore good to understand. But so what it does, one sentence, it tries to make the two expressions exactly the same by tactically binding variables. So if I ask you, so the unification operator, so this predicate, which for convenience can be given in the infix notation, just like the plus function that, just to demonstrate, so. So plus, like any function, so normally we write the Prolog terms that the function, the functor first, and then the arguments, but of course in arithmetic, so for the familiar infix notation has been defined. So similarly for the unification, unification is a predicate whose name is the equal sign. So succeed with the binding variable x to 2 plus 2, but so the familiar infix notation, so it is still allowed, so the exact same thing, just the syntactic variation. So can these two expressions to be made the same by binding variables? So ordinary assignment cannot do the following, that you could have an arbitrary expression here on the left-hand side. So can you make the expression x plus y to be exact same expression as 2 plus 3 by tactically binding variables? So the unification algorithm, remember that these are expressions as expression trees in the memory, so compares the root nodes, so both are pluses, so far so good, so both expressions have the same root operator, root node, and then tries to recursively unify the left subtrees and tries to unify the, so unifies x with 2, succeed, and then tries to unify y with 3, so succeed. So we get the solution x is 2 and y is 3. But now does the expression x plus x unify with the 2 plus 3? So this one doesn't, because so both expressions have the same functor, the plus, left-hand sides unify x and 2, so the base case of the recursion. So when one of the things is an unbound variable, so that automatically unifies with anything. So this could be foo divided by bar minus 7, so just to show that so a variable is an unbound variable is bound to the expression. So everything is just pointer comparisons and pointer assignment. Again, there is no strings in here. This is not any kind of a substring substitution or any other thing like that. But doesn't work the other way around, because once x has been bound to foo divided by bar minus 7, so x has been bound and cannot become unbound unless backtracking. So the very same x we now try to unify with 3, and of course foo, so the division operator is not the same thing as 3, and that fails right away. So now as a quick review, so 2 plus 2 equals 4. Everyone agrees that should be true, but surprise is not, because now unification, so we shouldn't be hallucinating all kinds of wonderful properties that we like it to have. So this is not an equation solver. No, it's not even like the simplest possible equation. So unification by variable variable bindings tries to make the two expressions to be the exact same expression. Nothing is evaluated. So evaluating this, so they would be the same value, but as a expressions, so one is a plus and the other one is an integer. So these don't unify. Now if you want to evaluate both sides, mathematically. So the is evaluates right hand side. So this one evaluates both sides. So then tries to make them the same. For the unification, so we can, like for example, foo 42 y. Let's unify it with the foo x and bar divided by 7. So we get the bindings. So 42 is so x is the unbound variable x is bound to 42 to make this unification to go through, and then the unbound variable y is bound to the expression bar divided by 7. Nothing is evaluated. Unification as a predicate is what is called the semi-deterministic, meaning that it either fails or it succeeds once. So now the unification, so how the math works out underneath the unification algorithm, that for any two terms, either they don't unify at all, or they have a unique, most general way to unify them, unique essentially without caring about the variable name. So this could be like a y. Well, there wasn't really what I meant to say, but then. So the recursive unification algorithm, as it makes the bindings that have to be made, then makes only those kind of forced bindings, and the resulting unifier is the most general possible, makes the fewest assumptions and the fewest bindings to get the result. But the unification cannot leave behind a choice point, and therefore backtracking will always skip over it. Now there's a couple of special cases still to know about this. We can make up our function. So is there an expression that syntactically is the same than applying f to that expression? So not a finite expression, no such one doesn't exist. Notice that nothing is evaluated. This is not a fixed point question for a function f. But the infinite looping term, where the x is bound to fx, so this kind of unification technically is incorrect. So we have to write our logical formula so that this kind of a thing cannot appear. Now in the manual, so unification, notice both the sides can be unbound, so either one. So question mark in that notation or predicate description was that must be bound to a partial term satisfying and including the unbound variables. And that the minus is the best one, so then it can be can be something. So this variation, this one doesn't warrant to make its own symbol, so the sound unification. So then this will cleverly realize that those two are different. Whereas then if this situation doesn't occur, so then this behaves like ordinary unification. One more thing about this unification, like I said, so that the unification algorithm, what it does, it first verifies that the both expressions have the same functor, the same root node, but then if that's the case, try to recursively unify the left sub-expressions and try to unify the right sub-expressions. But can we use a variable here? So doesn't this also unify, that may bind f to the symbol foo, but this one actually doesn't work. So this is actually a syntax error. So you cannot use an unbound, so the functor has to be a proper symbol. So the unification doesn't allow you to bind a variable into a functor. Now, why isn't the unify with a curse check the default? Because it's less efficient. So a unify with a curse check is a quadratic time Owen squared algorithm with respect to the expression size n, whereas ordinary unification is linear time, so massively more efficient. So because that situation that requires the unify with a curse check is so rare, that the language designer chose correctly the efficiency over a special case.